Well, a very good evening, and we welcome you to this gospel service from Grange Baptist Church. And tonight we have some praise and worship items to share with you, and also a children's talk as well. And then we come to declare a very important message from the Word of God. And so with all of that before us, let's just commit ourselves to the Lord in prayer. Let's ask for His blessing to be upon us in every area and in every aspect of this service, that truly He will have His own way in each of our hearts and each of our lives. Let's just pray together, please. Our God and our Father, we thank and we praise Thee for every good and for every perfect gift that Thou hast given to us. We praise Thee tonight that as we gather in Thy presence, we do so in and through the name of our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we praise Thee and we thank Thee that it is by Him that we have this access before Thy very throne. And at Thy throne we can present our wants and petitions before the great I Am. And we realize, Lord, that we bring nothing of merit in and of ourselves. But we praise Thee and we thank Thee tonight that we know even Thy blessing upon us, because Thou hast even invited us to come as we come in the name of Jesus Christ our Saviour. And so, Father, we pray for Thy blessing to be known, Thy help to be given, even in this service tonight, that in everything that is said and done, that it will bring glory to Thy high and to Thy holy name. We pray, Father, especially for the gospel as it's preached, as it's sang. We pray that it will find that resting place, even in the hearts and lives of both young and old alike. And there will be that great and gathering of souls, even into the kingdom as we gather. Father, we pray that Thou would bless each heart that's with us and tuned in to this service tonight. We pray that Thou would meet the needs that are present, that Thou would speak that word that is most needed even in this hour, and we'll praise Thee for all that Thou wilt do. So now, Lord, guide us and lead us, for it's in Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
First song we're going to sing tonight is called When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Wonderful mercy. To be here today to talk to you all, and missing you all already, even though it's just been a little short while, but really hoping to see you all soon, especially my Sunday school class. So I'm just going to bring you a few wee thoughts today. So if I was with you all now, I'd be asking you, what do I do for a job? And I know most of you, if not all of you, will know that I am a nurse. So I've got a wee helper here. I've got three helpers actually. So this is me. So here's me, little nurse. Unfortunately, you're not actually allowed flowers in hospitals, so that's not very accurate. So here's my first nurse. Here's my second nurse. Does anyone think these look like me, do they? And maybe more accurate at the minute. Maybe this is more like me at the minute. So this is my third nurse, okay? So that's what I do. And I'm very lucky that God has given me the skills to be able to help people. So I'm a surgical nurse. I look after people who are waiting to go to surgery or have surgery related issues. So it's quite difficult, but it's also very, very interesting. So God has allowed me to look after these people who are very, very sick, and sadly even people who are going to die. So it's a very hard job, but we're very lucky that I'm able to help people. So I've got a few of the tools that I use in the hospital. So the first thing is a stethoscope. So more so you see doctors using these, but they can be used for different things. Some specialist nurses use them too. So you pop them in your ear, and then you use this bit, and it can be used to listen to the lungs, or it can be used to listen to the heart. So it made me think that when they're listening, you know, for the heartbeat, they're listening to make sure the air is going in and into the lungs and out of the lungs. They'll hold it in around your back to sort of hear the air going in and out. So for being such a small piece of tool, it's really, really important, and it can hear the heartbeat clearly. And it made me think that every single time they listen to it, They listen to a heart that has a different beat. Some people will go very fast. Some people's will be very slow. Some people's will be irregular. Sometimes it'll go fast, and then a couple of seconds it'll be slow. People will breathe at different rates, and people will breathe deeper. So everybody is so unique. And it just made me think that God put that specific heart and that specific set of lungs into each person. So he give you the heart and the lungs that you have for a special purpose. So many kids tell me, say, oh, I don't know what I'm good at. My friend's better than me at this. But they're not you. They haven't got those heart and those lungs that God gave you for a purpose. So sometimes you can put your fingers onto your wrist and you can feel your heartbeat. So every time you feel that heartbeat, you know that your heart is beating for a reason. And God put that heart in you to give you energy and to give you blood flowing through your body so that you could do things, great things for him. So that's my first piece of equipment. Also alongside that, we use these together as nurses. This is called a sphygmomanometer. I can hardly say it myself. So we pop this round the arm. You've seen this, and then we puff this all up and we get your blood pressure. So same again, we have to have this heart pumping and we have to have all this blood going through our veins so that we can live and do lots of great things for God. So next time you're having your blood pressure check, maybe when you're a bit older, or all you older children, you remember that you are blessed and you are lucky to have a heart that is beating, that you can do great things for God. The next thing is this. You can maybe hardly see it. This is what we call in nursing a fob watch, or just a watch. This goes onto our uniforms and then we flip it up and we can tell the time. But one of the main things we use it for is counting how many times someone would breathe in a minute. And it just made me think again about time. We're given so much time by God. And we've been given even more time to think and do things during this lockdown. But I just was thinking, what do we use our time for? Every time I'm looking at this in work, I'm thinking, oh my goodness, how's another couple of hours went past and I've hardly done anything? I have 15 patients all screaming at me looking for paracetamol for a sore head. But it just made me think, what do we use our time for? We are given this time every day, a whole new set of 24 hours. What are we wasting our time? Are we saying, oh, I haven't got time to read my Bible. I haven't got time to do this Bible study. I haven't got time to pray. But what did you do with that time? Did you play an extra hour of the PlayStation? Did you spend too long playing outside with your friends? Did you maybe spend too long tidying your bedroom? Maybe you have to stop that. But what do we use our time for? So this is for everyone, young people, old people. So every time I see a clock now, I'm just thinking, preparing for this, what have I used the last hour for? Have I even prayed to God? Have I done anything that will glorify God with the time that I have been given and the time that has just passed? So that's what I would use that for. Another thing, they're a bit fancier than this in the hospital, but this is my one at home. Lots of people will have these at the minute with the virus going about. But obviously, you all know this is a thermometer. It goes under the tongue and you get a high temperature or a low temperature, or a temperature that's okay. So we would use these in the hospital. We pop them in the ear and then they beep and they tell us what the temperature is. And how I thought about this and God and the gospel was, are we hot or are we cold for God? If we're a Christian, are we cold? Are we doing nothing? Our tank that's full of activity for God, is it freezing cold? Is it icicles dripping off it? Have we done anything that is keeping us on fire for God? Or is our temperature for God, is our temperature really high? Are we doing lots of activities for God? Are we interacting in Sunday school? Are we helping out in church wherever we can? Are we really on fire for God? Are we really doing everything that we could possibly do for God? Are we keeping our temperature high? So next time your temperature is being checked, you think, am I hot or am I cold in my work for God? And finally, we have a variety of dressings. So we are all in the hospital used to doing lots of dressings, and people have sores and cuts. I have people with surgical wounds in their tummy and different areas in their body. But I was thinking that we have a wound that is so much greater than any of these wounds that I dress in the hospital. We have a wound that's deep within us that is called sin. And sin has caused these wounds in our body. And I have lots of different dressings, but I just don't think these dressings would cover our sins. So maybe if I stick this across my head, I'll have no sin no more, because a sticky plaster solves everything. If you stick a plaster on anything, it's fixed, it's healed. So we've different ones, we've bigger ones, we've smaller ones. So if you've just told a wee lie, just one wee lie today, maybe just sticking a sticky plaster over it, just saying, nobody saw it, I'll just cover it with this plaster, that's it, all solved. Or maybe you've told a couple of lies and maybe you stole some money, or maybe you hit your friend in school, so maybe you need a bigger plaster and you try and cover up that sin with a bigger plaster. Or you try and lie about the fact that you told a lie and you're getting, your wounds getting bigger, your cuts are getting wider opened. Or sometimes, you know, you keep repetitively doing the same things. So we have some older people who, you know, maybe keep hitting their elbows off things or keep hitting their arms off cabinets, and they keep breaking down their skin, getting cuts in their skin. So we would use some of this wool dressing and we'd wrap them all up in their arm to try and protect their skin, or around their feet or their ankles or their legs. We would dress them with this wool and that would keep them protected. So maybe we think, we keep going to the wrong place. We keep going out to a place with our friends. It's not a place that we should be. And we think, right, we'll wrap ourselves up in this wool. We'll not let anyone know we're going there. We'll just go there, but we'll not tell anyone. So we'll keep ourselves covered. We'll keep ourselves protected, and nobody will know that that's where we're going. But you know who knows? God. God always knows. And even if your family never found out that you were saying those things, telling those lies, saying those bad words, and making jokes about God in school, your family may never know. Some of your other friends, your Christian friends, may never know, but God will know. And no amount of wool covering your body or you protecting, trying to protect the sin that you do, will ever stop you getting these cuts and these wounds in your body. There's nothing that can cover sin, because God sees everything. So we talk a lot in my Sunday school class about how we think we just do wee sins, but a wee sin is just as bad as a massive sin, the worst sin you could ever think of. So finally, I was thinking then about this hole. So you imagine you have a hole that can't be filled. So there's no amount of scans I could take you to as a nurse. I could prepare you for 500 surgeries, but that will never solve this hole within you. There's only one thing, and we all know what it is. There's only one thing, and that's God. That is asking God to come into your life and fill that hole, that gap, that no dressing, no covering, no surgery could ever fix. The last suggestion might be, we'll use these special dressings in the hospital, and this is a rope dressing, and we use this along with a wee sterile stick, and we poke this into a little hole, and that helps the wound heal from the inside out. So that's it, that's the solution. We have to just open up and poke this into all the sin holes that can't be filled, and that's it solved with this rope dressing. But we all know that's not the case. God sent his son, his only son, to die on the cross. And that was the only way that hole, that sin, that emptiness within us can be filled. We try and fill it with money. We try and fill it with our hobbies, football, celebrities, work, promotions. We try and fill it with everything that's wrong. But the only thing that can fill it is asking the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart, telling him that you did wrong, telling him that you're a sinner and you know you do bad things and that you will continue to do bad things, but that you know that he sent his only son to die on the cross to take all of our punishment, and you ask him to come into your life and to fill that hole. And I just wanted to leave you with a verse that I really like and that everyone, most people really like, and it's in Ephesians, and it's in Ephesians chapter 2 verses 8 and 9. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of ourselves, it is the gift of God. I'll read that bit again. And that not of ourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So no matter what we do, it's not of ourselves. No matter how many solutions we try and do, we can never solve this problem we have. And I just really hope that if you're in hospital, and hopefully you won't be, or that you're at your GP, or getting any blood tests, if you see these different things being used on you, it'll just make you think of how it applies to you in your life. Hope to see you all soon, and everybody keep safe. Bye.
Hello and welcome to our church service. Here are some announcements for this week. If you would like to come to church on Monday night for prayer, please book in with the pastor or Keith. Wednesday night, the prayer meeting is on Zoom, so contact the pastor for login details. Sunday, We hope to see you back in church, God willing, with Sunday school at 10:30 and church services at 12 noon and 7 p.m. Boys and girls, remember your worksheets. See you next week. Bye.
The next song we're going to sing together is Ding Dong Merrily on High.
Once again, I want to say thank you to all those who have been involved in our services today, and it's been great even to see so many different people take part. And truly we pray that it's been a blessing to each of our hearts, and we want to say thank you especially to those who have helped in so many different ways at this time and given up of their time even to do so. And we pray that even as we continue that the Lord will bless us, and we look forward to being back together very soon, and we pray that the Lord will hear and answer prayer even in that regard. Now, by the wonders of modern technology, I'm not also preaching here at Grange tonight, but I'm preaching as well in Lurgan Baptist at this very same hour. And so be praying right now that the Lord will bless as I preach live there and truly use the words that are spoken to even speak into the hearts and lives of those who hear via that broadcast. But we pray that the Lord will bless us even as we share in the gospel now. And we're going to turn in our Bibles to John's Gospel in the chapter 5. John's Gospel in the chapter 5. We're going to read together from the verse 1 of the chapter. John's Gospel in the chapter 5, reading together from the verse 1. After this there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then, first after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie, and knew that he had now been a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Amen. And we know that the Lord will add his own blessing once more to the public reading of his word. Now as we come into this passage in John's Gospel in the chapter 5, we read a very unique portion of scripture. For here we see a great miracle that has been conducted by the Lord Jesus Christ. For as John records even for us here, we see that this is a very special occasion, this is a very special moment, and indeed one to remember in the lives of so many who beheld it that day. But no more so, of course, than the man who was there with a certain infirmity, the Bible tells us. And having had that infirmity, he suffered for over 38 years. And so as he met the Lord Jesus Christ, truly this was a day to remember. Why? Because everything that had been known heretofore was suddenly changed in a moment. And he knew what it was to leave that day completely transformed, completely changed. And so as we come to consider this tonight, that is truly our endeavor, that is truly our prayer, that as you hear even the message from the Word of God this hour, that you too in your own heart and in your own life will be forever changed, that you will look back to this moment in eternity, whenever God took a dealing and whenever God spoke words whereby you might be saved. And so let's come to consider the words of John's Gospel in the chapter 5 and these first 9 verses that we've read together. And let's notice, first of all, the man's condition. The man's condition. For the Bible tells us that as Jesus went up to Jerusalem, coming to observe a feast, for remember, of course, he was one who identified himself with the Jewish people of that place and indeed sought to minister to them and to others, but nevertheless observed the feasts, observed their remembrances, even as the scriptures would have commanded. And so coming into Jerusalem, he came at a certain feast time, a time whenever many people would have been gathered together, a time whenever indeed there would have been much activity within the city. But there was at Jerusalem, the Bible tells us in verse 2, by that sheep market, by the sheep gate of the city, a pool which is in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda. And it was a very special pool, a very unique pool, for it had five porches. And within those five porches, the Bible tells us that a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, they all were gathered together in that place. And this was where the Lord Jesus Christ was to be found. And as he was there, the Bible draws attention to one specific man, for in verse 5 it tells us a certain man. And remember, this was a place where a great multitude of people were gathered together, but nevertheless, the Lord had his heart set upon, and his eye set upon, and his mind set upon, and his desire set upon one man. The Bible tells us he was a certain man, but the Lord knew everything about him, for there he was suffering from his infirmity for 38 years. And the Bible tells us when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been a long time in that case, oh, the Lord knew everything about him. He knew the very individual to whom he was going that day. He knew the circumstances that individual was found in. He knew the condition that he suffered from. And indeed, he knew the thoughts of the heart, the burden of the heart, the longing of the heart. And friend, tonight as we gather, make no mistake that just as the Lord knew everything about that man, so too he knows everything about you. And it's no mistake tonight that you're tuning in. It's no mistake tonight that you're hearing this message. It's no mistake tonight that we're turning to this passage. It's no mistake tonight that once again you're exposed to and confronted with the truth of the gospel. For God has an interest in you. Jesus Christ has his mind, has his eye, has his heart set upon you. And he desires to do something in your life which will truly testify to the glory and to the honor of his name. The Bible tells us that as this multitude is found there, there are a multitude with many needs. For they were there for a specific reason also. They knew what it was to suffer from disease. They knew what it was to suffer from illness. And yes, their symptoms may have differed. And yes, indeed, the condition with which they lived in their lives and how that affected their lives and how it affected their day-to-day processes may have differed one to another. But nevertheless, this was a company of sick people. They were all there because there was a certain time whenever an angel would come and trouble the water. And after that troubling of the water, if they stepped into the pool that was to be found there, then healing was to be known. So these sick people were all gathered in the one place with the one desire. They desired to be healed. They desired to have that change effected in their lives and in the condition that they suffered from. They wanted to be free from illness. They wanted to be free from disease. They wanted to be able to live life to its fullest. And this certain man, the Bible tells us, was there and he had an infirmity, 38 years, and he's then described as being one who lies even about all the time, and then described in verse 7 as being an impotent man. He describes his own condition. He says, Lord, I'm not able to get up off my bed. I'm not able to make my way from where I'm lying to the pool. I'm unable to walk. And so we believe very much that this man was one who was paralyzed. He suffered from some degree of paralysis. He was not able in and of himself to move freely. And therefore he lay by that pool. He suffered by that pool. And for 38 years, this had been the reality of his life. This had been his day-to-day experience. And there was something which barred him from enjoying the full benefits of life. This was the condition that this man was in. Friend, as we gather together, this it's a very description of this man before us tonight. This very neatly describes the condition of all mankind. For yes, our faces may differ. And oh yes, the lives that we live may differ. And the things that we do, the choices that we make, The laws of God that we transgress may differ from one person to another, but you and I suffer from the same illness, the same sickness, the same disease, the same blemish and mark in our lives, and it is the condition of sin. And friend, tonight as we come together around the Word of God, understand that as you gather here, and yes, it's true that the Lord Jesus Christ knew all about this man, and yes, it's true that it was no mistake that He was there that day, and that the Lord was there that day, and it's no mistake that you're here tonight, and that you're hearing these words tonight, but it's also a reality tonight that God is not mistaken about your condition. He knows that we're all born exactly the same way, in sin, separated from God. Tonight, you're here gathered with us, still in that same sin-sick condition. Well, friend, continue to listen, for there's news that God desires you to hear. For as we behold this story, we must not only note upon this man's condition, but we also must remark upon this man's expectation. For being found in this pool of Bethesda, this place where the five porches were found, this place where the pool of water that the angel came and from time to time troubled it in order to produce that miracle working power was found. So this man dwelt and lived his life there beside that pool. But notice in verse 7, he says, "Sir, I have no man." He's all alone. Yes, there's a multitude of people around him. But there are a multitude of people in exactly the same condition as he was. And therefore, yes, he's found numbered amongst many people, but he's very much alone. I wonder tonight, does that describe you? Well, yes, you live in a world filled with 7 billion people. You may live even in a household that has several people coming and going from it on a daily basis. But perhaps tonight it's right to say that very often in your life you feel all alone. And you feel like no one truly knows the burden of life that you carry. No one knows the trouble that you face. No one knows the difficulties that you're going through. No one knows anything that truly weighs you down or gets you down. No one truly knows. And because no one knows, you also feel that no one cares. Well, that all changed for this man, didn't it? For after 38 years of suffering from this condition, and after many times of seeing that water troubled and being unable in and of himself to get to that place where healing was to be found, suddenly he was face to face with Christ. And in that moment he realized that he was no longer alone. And in that moment he realized that that before him was someone who truly cared. Oh, we don't know if this man had family. We don't know if he had brothers and sisters. We don't know if he had mother and father still remaining and alive upon this earth. All we know is that he's found there alone, and he's found in a state of desperation, and his testimony is, "No one cares for me." And then Christ came. And remember, this was the day when everything changed, and in that moment he realized he was never alone, and in that moment he realized that someone, Christ, cared for him. Oh friend, tonight that's the news that we share. That's the message that we declare. That although you may be one who feels alone day by day here in this world, and you may even in your own life feel that no one truly cares, I remind you from Scripture, and I tell you from Scripture with great authority, that there is one in heaven who, yes, knows all about you, but he also cares for you. Jesus Christ cares. He cares about the struggle that you face. He cares about the burden that you carry. He cares about the condition of sin in which you still remain, and he wishes to do something about it. But not only was this man all alone, but we see very clearly even from this testimony he gives in verse 7 that this was a man who was downtrodden and discouraged. We don't know how many times he knew the angel to come down and troubled that water. We don't know how many times he was filled with anticipation. If only I could get to that pool. If only I could be the first person to dip my feet into that water. but then perhaps someone walked over him. Perhaps someone pushed him to the side, or perhaps he just saw someone from the far side of that other side of the porch, and they rushed forward and they made the water first and they were healed. We don't know how many times he witnessed that. We don't know how many times that sense of anticipation, that sense of excitement arose within him, only to be beat down straight away because he realized he was never going to be able to get there. And so we see a man who was downtrodden and deeply discouraged because he recognized and he realized that unless something else happened, he was never going to know the healing that he desired. Do you know that in our lives very often we come across false dawns? Perhaps it's in that moment of time whenever we reflect on our lives and we reflect on our hearts and we reflect on our sinful condition and we say to ourselves, we're going to turn over a new leaf. We're going to try to do it God's way. We're going to try to live our lives the best that we can. We're going to not give in to that sin anymore. We're not going to give in to that addiction anymore. We're not going to chase the things of the world. No, we're going to try to live a pious life. We're going to try to live a disciplined life. We're going to try to live a good life. And oh, we're filled with anticipation, we're filled with excitement. And we think, yes, tomorrow's going to be a better day. I've got a better mindset, there's a better way that I can do things, and I've got my plan and I'm going to stick to it. And if I just be able to get to tomorrow, everything's going to be different. But nothing is. All of that elation, all of that excitement, all of that anticipation soon disappears. It soon disappears. And so we see that he's downtrodden and discouraged. But notice with me also in verse 6 there, the Bible tells us that when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been a long time in that case, he saith unto him, wilt thou be made whole? Now remember, this is a man who is sick. This is a man who is riddled with disease. This is a man who is in and of himself unable to get from where he's lying to a pool just a few steps away. And so we know that he's lying there because he wants to be healed. He wants life to be different. And Jesus Christ comes up to him that day and he says unto him, wilt thou be made whole? Look at the response of the man in verse 7. Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am a coming, another steppeth down before me. Did he even answer the question that Christ asked in verse 6? No. He started to blame his circumstances. He started to blame his surroundings. He started to blame all of the things that he saw as pitfalls or challenges that he was unable to overcome. And he said, if simply all of that was different, then I'd know what it was to be made whole. But Christ had asked him, do you want to be made whole? Friend, many of us identify things in our lives that are wrong. And I have known many people to be found still lost in sin, and they identify in their own hearts and they identify in their own lives the great need that is there. But so often when they're challenged, when they're asked, do you want to come to Christ? Do you want to know what it is to have forgiveness of sin? Do you want to know what it is to have assurance of heaven? Here's what they say. If only this was different. If only I was able to go here, if only I was able to go there, excuse me, if only this person wasn't in my life, if only that person wasn't in my life, then everything would be different. But it never is. And oh friend, tonight we come to the Word of God, and this man helps us to understand that it's not because of our circumstances. It's not because of the people who are in our life, who are not in our life. Because of our own heart. Excuse me. And we need to identify within our own hearts and within our own lives the problem, the real problem that exists. And except we answer the question that is extended in the gospel, do you wish to be made whole? We'll never know the change that we desire. Oh, this man had an expectation that he wanted to be healed, but he had his own idea of how that would be accomplished. I know it wasn't the way that God intended. He's there all alone. He's there downtrodden, downbeaten. He's there discouraged. He's there blaming his circumstances. And we could go as far as to say he's there with a fatalistic attitude. He's simply one who says, I'll do it someday, and if it's not to be, well, I don't think it's going to happen. He's resigned to his doom. He's resigned to his fate. He's fatalistic in how he approaches this whole affair, how his mind now focuses in and truly deals with the problem that is before him. A friend, tonight, I wonder, are you just one who resigns yourself to the fate? I'll always be a sinner. I'll never be able to kick that habit. I'll never be able to get it right with God. I'll never be able to live a disciplined, consistent life. I'll never be able to live as the Bible commands. Are you fatalistic in your approach? Oh, friend, tonight that's the expectation that this man testifies of. Is it the expectation with you? But remember, this whole passage is constructed around and centers around the very fact that Christ was before this man. The one who could change everything about him. The one who could answer his greatest problem. The one who could meet his greatest need. And there he was, face to face with the incarnate Christ. And yet he still struggled to reach out and to grab hold of that which Christ was offering. Why? Because he held himself back. So many times it's true that a sinner knows what it is to be convicted. They know what it is to be troubled in their own hearts at the moving of the Spirit. And they know what it is to have before them the very opportunity to reach out and to take hold upon everything that they would desire. But they hold themselves back. Don't let it be you tonight. Don't let your expectation be of full and final doom. No, rather reach out, accept all that Christ offers. Believe in Him for your soul's salvation. Not only do we see this man's condition, not only do we see this man's expectation, but we see thirdly and finally this man's transformation. Remember, the Lord said to him in verse 6, "Wilt thou be made whole?" The man, after he had given him that answer that didn't really answer the question, the Lord said in verse 8, "Rise, take up thy bed, and walk." And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Remember, this was a man who for 38 years could not accomplish the very thing he was able to do that day. This was a man who never knew what it was to have that freedom and that ability to move from where he lay to the pool. But there he was, walking about the city just a couple of minutes later. And oh, he knew what it was to receive the answer to his problem, the answer to his desire, the answer to his prayer. And surely all along he realized in his own heart that he had been greatly mistaken. You see, there he is, found in Bethesda. There he is, found in that place that is known as the House of Mercy. And oh, he thought that if only he could get into the water, as long as he was in Bethesda, as long as he was before the pool, as long as the angel came down and he was there, and he was able to get from where he lay and into the pool, everything would be all right. But he failed to recognize that his hope and his confidence shouldn't have been in a place, it shouldn't have been in a thing, it should have been in a person. Because he was face to face with the miracle worker, Jesus Christ. Now, friend, tonight I urge you, as we come to the gospel, as we behold the things that are recorded here in this passage, as we know them to be true, as I myself have experienced them to be true, and tonight preach unto you so you can experience them to be true. Do not place your hope, do not place your confidence, do not place anything about the temporal things of life and the people or the things of life, and rather place them on the unchanging person of Jesus Christ. He alone it is who is able to meet the need of your soul. He alone it is who is able to touch you and to make you whole. And so we see in this man, he had his confidence placed in the wrong place. It should have always been in a person. As long as he could get to the pool was his thought. Or all along, it should have been as long as he could get to Christ. And oh friend, tonight Christ is standing, waiting, ready to receive you. And just like this man, you need to rise up from where you are. You need to cast away that old bed of sin that you've been lying in, that you've been wallowing in, that old life that you've been living for the last number of weeks, months and years. You need to leave it all behind. You need to forsake it all and get to Christ. You need to come to Him who alone is able to answer the need of your sin-sick soul, who alone is able to meet the greatest need of your heart, of your life. Come and receive of His salvation today. Oh, no one had to tell this man that he was sick. The evidence was all around. The evidence was in his reality every single day. So too, no one needs to tell you, friend, tonight that you're lost, perishing and dying in your sin. You know it's true. You know that the life that you're living, it's not really a life at all. There's no lasting contentment, joy, or satisfaction to be found in anything that you're engaged in. You know that in your own heart and your own soul you're sick. And you can do nothing to cure the sickness nor the disease that you're suffering from. There's nothing that you can do to change your lost and hopeless condition. So friend, tonight we point you to Christ. The one who is mercy. You no longer need to present yourself in the house of mercy. You no longer need to come to a place. You no longer need to come and avail of a thing. You need to get to the person. The one who alone can save. And oh friend, tonight realize that as the Lord is working in your heart, it's just like is described there in verses 3 and 4. There's a moving in your heart. As there was in that water, as the sick people lay before it. But God is working, God is striving, the Spirit of God is moving and seeking to draw you onto Christ, to draw you from the paths of sin, to draw you from that bed of sin, and to bring you to the place where you'll bow the knee, believe in Christ alone for your soul's salvation. Will you hear? Will you listen? Will you respond? See, this man was given a challenge. He had to rise, he had to take up his bed, and he had to walk. The voluntary reaction is seen in the rising. The taking up of the bed is the forsaking of our old lifestyle. And the walking is the evidence of the change that has been effected. And that is exactly what Christ desires for you tonight. He desires for you in and of yourself to come to Him, to respond to the wooing and to the drawing of the Spirit and how God is speaking in your heart, that you will reply and say, "Yes, Lord, I repent of my sin. I forsake this old bed that I've been lying on. I forsake it all. I forsake the sin. I forsake the things of this world. I forsake the addictions that have held me for so long. I forsake the temptations that have so easily I have succumbed to and fallen to. And I come to you and I'm going to walk. I'm going to walk before my brothers and my sisters, my husband, my wife. I'm going to walk before my neighbors. I'm going to walk before my school colleagues, my work colleagues. I'm going to walk in my community and I'm going to seek to live a life which demonstrates the change that you have done in my life." Oh God, the Son completely transformed this man. And He can completely transform you. You know, I wonder as He walked around the city that day, were there those who perhaps from time to time would have looked into Bethesda and said, "There's that man over there. Oh, he's been there such a long time." But on this day, on this Sabbath day, they perhaps seen Him walking, running down the street. Such a change. such a transformation, such a testimony to the work that God can do. Are you willing to let Him do it in your life? Are you willing to let Him in? Are you willing to come to Him, repent of your sin, and receive the transformation that He alone can offer? Oh, this man had a condition. It speaks to us of the condition that we all have as we're born into this world, the sin condition. He had an expectation. He thought that there was a way that he could deal with it. He thought that if only he could get to the pool. But then he had to realize that it wasn't the pool he needed to get to, it was the person. It was Christ alone who had the answer. Coming to Christ, then we see His transformation. Tonight, will that be your testimony? Tonight, will tonight be the night that you close in and you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior? Oh, I pray that you will. I pray that God will have His own way in your heart. I pray that you'll forsake the bed of sin. I pray that you will come, that you will arise and go to Jesus. You'll repent and put your faith and trust in Him alone for your soul's salvation. May God transform you tonight. And may He set you on that road for heaven and for home as you walk for Him here below. Father, we want to thank Thee and praise Thee for all that Thou hast blessed us with in Thy Word. We're thankful that it is the eternal, unchangeable Word of God. And so, Father, it has that Word that communicates to us very clear and evident truth for each of our hearts and for each of our lives. We pray that Thou wouldst be pleased to have Thine own way in the hearts of those who gather with us tonight around Thy Word, but who are yet outside of Thee. We pray that tonight will be the night that they close in, that they receive of the full and free pardon that Thou alone art able to give. Oh, Father, may tonight they break the chains and the bonds of addiction. May tonight be the night that they forsake the sin and the temptations of this time. May tonight be the night that they are transformed, an ever-living testimony of the work that God can do in the heart of just one. We're thankful that You're interested in individuals. We pray that Thou wouldst do Thy work in the heart of the individual tonight. And we'll praise Thee and we'll thank Thee for it. In Jesus' name. Amen.